Okie doke then. Well, good evening and welcome to the Planning Committee of Crewe Town Council on Monday the 27th of June. Do we have any apologies for absence?
Councillors Dunlop, Aylin and Houston.
Item 2, to note declarations of members' interest as the agenda is written. Anybody have any? No? Okay. Item 3 then, to confirm and sign the minutes of the Planning Committee held on the 23rd of May. And I shall initial that now.
I think the members and relay after Chair.
I'll move.
Is that a term, yeah, is that a two record and can you propose it please?
Yeah. I'll move, okay. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll see that then. Then. A little bit premature on that, are you? Want it to win. Okay, thank you for that. Okay, then, very seriously. So, okay, item 4, public participation. Do we have any letters, any comments, anything from members of the public or any other councillor?
No, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Welcome. Okay, then. So, item 5, to consider making a response. The following planning applications, if we so desire. So we'll take them in the order that they're down on the paper. And the first one is 221506 CCTV Column, Queen's Park. Is there any comment? Is anything?
There's comments to be in front of you right now. There's another sheet there with any heritage offers and comments. Other than that, there are no other concerns. It's CCTV to address and social behaviour in Queen's Park. There is a consideration associated with the fact that the park is listed, the lodge buildings are listed. What the proposal is for the protection of heritage assets as well as the rest of the park. So the comments of the heritage officer support it and recognise it.
Okay. Are we okay then with that? To leave it at that. Come at a good time because there was a fire there last week on in the bins, wasn't there? By one of the lodges.
Is that what it was? The bins, was that?
I like to believe that, yeah. Okay. So that's, and it's not, yeah.
Is that where people are stripping bark off the trees as well? Has that been happening?
It probably is, I don't know.
All right, okay. Okay, well, thanks for the heritage officer for that. We'll move on then. So 22-1766. Change of use for mixed use taxi business to Generous on a ground floor with one self contained two bedroom flat at first floor to mixed use retail shop on ground floor and two number self contained one bedroom flats at first floor, 9 Hightown.
Do you want to bring it up? I have a
look. Yeah, oh, yeah. Please, okay. Just get into the field.
221766.
There's bearings. Go away,
you can. There are no negative submissions of anyone else's comments associated with this. Where are we? Location plan.
This backs onto the car park on Hightown.
Yes. It's that side there. Plans are proposed for plans. Round four shopping units relatively unchanged. Sorry, it takes a little bit of time to catch up. The access to the upstairs through here. And then last will be sort of mirror images into it. One being this end, and the other one being the zoom map at that. Living room, kitchen, four bedroom, the room sizes meet the technical standards. That's where we're at with it, really. It's not too challenging. The only comments I managed to work out is the details of the waste storage haven't been worked out, as far as I can understand it. There's only details of waste storage here. Does that fulfill the residential and the commercial use?
Yeah, still got a shop, aren't we?
What about a car parking?
Well, there's no car parking. We can comment on that, obviously, if you mind. There's no bike storage listed either. I can identify anyway. But in terms of scale, the use themselves are approximately within the technical standards. So 37 square meters for a two-person, one-bedroom unit. It's supposed to be 39 square meters, but it doesn't take into account all the storage and things that are associated. So it's in the region of.
Any comment? I thought it's actually two flats, which is...
It does look like two flats, yeah, because the kitchens are integrated with the living rooms.
Yeah.
It's less likely to be subdivided, because it's unlikely that someone's going to want to subdivide and live in there or come in and out for the kitchens.
Yeah.
Okay. So, looking at what you said then, there's no designated for waste. And industrial waste because of business waste, because clearly it is a ground floor job. And you usually want car parking, and they usually give us. Is there a rear yard as such?
There is a rear yard, yeah, but they go in and out through the front. So access to the rear yard is not achieved for the flats, they actually ingress that way. So the detail and the how the bins will be stored, they expect to go around the back and be sustainable for your comment. So that needs detail there.
Okay. Anybody want to add anything extra or?
Looks like a reasonable development. As part of the parking being an issue. It look okay.
I think we should ask about the parking.
Yeah. Where it costs. Well, no, we pull that one.
Yeah, we don't have that.
Consistency.
And, also, is there enough room for the bins?
Are we responding that we have no objection in principle, but that the designs don't provide adequate details of waste storage to include commercial and residential waste, access to the waste, at the rear of the property from the upstairs, the first floor, details of bike storage and inadequate parking.
Sounds good for me.
Yeah.
Sound okay?
Yeah.
Okay, then I've got another overwhelm, so that's okay then. Thank you. Next one then, 214750, change of use from retail and residential flat above into single residential dwelling. I believe this has been. I've checked this and this has been passed already.
Yeah, decision was made. The routine has been up until now to once you receive one of these applications and the deadline is before a committee meeting is to inform them, well, they tell them when after the meeting. On every occasion that's happened, apart from this one.
Yeah.
So later on the agenda it says, do you want me to be responding in the delegation?
Well, if it's going back to the house as far as I'm concerned,
well, let's leave that then until we get on to the
bit. Yeah, but if it doesn't do now, decisions maybe.
Yeah, yes. Okay, next one then. 22-1542, to partly take down a 1960s vestry block and reconstruct, extending this to the west and north within an existing garden area to provide additional loos. Enlarged meeting space for after service use together with good sized kitchen and storage, St Andrew's Church. And we have comment on our heritage paper.
Yeah, again, my support with those.
Have you got a copy of that, Kelly?
Yeah, the heritage. One more next to your paperwork when we, that's it. Yeah.
Set one down. So So what do, what's it saying there that could build the green?
It, it's not, the bit that they're working on is the most important part of the building. It's not an overly sensitive building, it's not listed, although it's listed. But the principle of minimal intervention is welcomed as the material choice which mirrors the existing fabric, which includes. So it, it's not a, a risky one, but submit the comments anyway.
Certainly needs an update. I've got members going in there. It's very, you know, needed an overhaul for some time, I think. Yes.
So we're okay with that then? Yeah. We'll, yes, we'll include that in.
Yeah,
I'll go around that. Okay. 22-21-58, front porch, side and rear extension, 288 Badger Avenue.
Travel
is
good.
This in scale?
It's in scale with the plot, but there's no, no responses. Let's just get the submitted plans. Site locations usually show it's quite a large plot. Right. There we go. So there's the existing, and they're putting this sort of wrap around extension all the way along to there, along the non-adjoining part of the semi-detached, which sits on a plot there, so it's quite long. So it's taking this side aspect here and bringing it around to the back there. The floor plan, so you can see the floor plan at the rear mirrors the width of the property. The corridor along the side.
Doesn't seem to interfere with the neighbours.
No, this aspect here already exists. No comments on the portal. Okay with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So we're okay then, yeah, colleagues?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay then. Next one then, 21. This has been around then. 21-64-63, second story side extension, 10 Balmoral Avenue. We need to look at this if it's 21. Is there a reason? Is it gone? Has it just got lost in the system?
Plans and public on there.
They're wrong. They're from a different.
Oh, they're missed
the
UI.
They've
been posted
against the wrong.
Yeah, there's a couple of that, haven't they? Yeah, noticed that.
Yeah, I was reading about a medical centre or something.
Yeah, there's another one from Middlewich. When I was starting to read, there's somebody who's objecting to the. He told me he won't build at the back of the house.
So that's that one. Sorry, Chair.
Sorry.
That's the plot there.
Yeah. All right.
Some context coming out again.
Because again, it's quite a big plot, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, it's not disproportionate. Mm. And that's the effectively the upstairs of the build on to that aspect there.
Right.
It's going to be very slow, sorry, we'll catch up in a second.
Seems to have enough room to be able to put it, but does it interfere with their neighbours?
Well, they haven't got any side windows on the elevations. And don't know the comments from the neighbours, yeah, and it has been there quite a long time.
So just for the meeting, those two addresses there, they're not.
Yeah, I think someone got dyslexic with the numbers.
Yeah, because I don't recollect a Frank Keating clogs.
I was referring to something he has linked to.
Three-storey flats are totally out of character today. It's not a three-storey flat.
It's a medical centre. So we need to establish when that isn't right what they put on there.
You want me to submit that they've got the wrong comments on?
Well, I think because it's not the, it won't be the only one tonight, because I've looked, when I looked prior to the meeting through if there's any comments, and
yeah,
there was some from Middlewich on one of them. First page, and then the second page was all clear. So I do think
I can,
just you know,
they relate to 6364, not 6463.
Ah, right, is that what it is?
Yeah,
6364. Ah, well done. There we go.
Excellent.
I will,
okay,
I'll email the case officer.
Yeah, they don't put it in the book. So, are we okay with it? That's the main bit.
It doesn't seem overly contentious to me.
Because the point is, they may actually not be on the correct one, and then they may start on that.
So,
okay. Hopefully, the next one will be okay. 21 for 5030. Or 5300, so we look at. Advert consent for proposed sales signage and promotional flags. It's promoted, I assume it's the estate, it's the builders, is it?
Oh,
yeah.
Not too worried.
No,
yeah, okay.
Oh, I don't think we're too worried on that, are we?
But I didn't identify any more tips.
It's not going to stay there for a week.
Let's get down to business then. 22-1888. Change of use from storage unit to rear of existing pub, in brackets previously approved for conversion to an HMO, to self-contained serviced accommodation unit, Sugen, for short-term stay and in brackets not permanent residence. The NAGZ, 157 Market Street. We may comment on the original application, which we found was an old development and lots of words around that. And now this is an outhouse, for want of a better word, where they want to have people stopping overnight or short term. So,
is it what we would call bed and breakfast?
I think it's a lot below that. I think it's very, very light touch Airbnb. If I may share, the proposals to the scale is an idea of a short-term holiday or business let or something. It's not something to be too worried about, and the worry I would have is that it's not enforced, and how could it be policed? I think it would be a low-quality residential let by stealth. My significant concern. I don't know how the planning authority would have the means or the opportunity to challenge that.
Right, I'm sure someone would like to comment on that. Let's just have a look and then we'll get a feel. But it's just that it would have been a bottling room or something, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Because even it's a pub.
In the basis of, so this is the all of here, so it's the effectively the bed sits and the HMO, the
directed over there.
And then this is the backyard, like say, with a bit of storage unit or something, bottles and stuff. They've created a yard here, there's some bins and some bike storage, and they're converting this shed or outhouse, which is a perfectly reasonable description of it, into a ground floor kitchen, sitting room, very small shower, bathroom here, and then this is, and then a mezzanine floor above for a single bed. essentially, it's a short term, yeah,
just for people passing through
the night. The application there is self contained service accommodation, yeah, short term stay. Yeah, I have a significant fear that the under definition of that and the lack of opportunity to enforce would be a risk of providing low quality accommodation below technical housing standards.
Yes.
Well, I've been in the late said a few times. Where that is that sort of right in the middle of, it's not alongside the road, is it?
No.
No, There's Market Street, that's another corner, and it's a side entrance yard from there.
It's American Street, where they came.
I mean, it lends itself to either a drying area because you've got an HMO where people have got no inside space. So you've got outside, you could have a good outside space for people who live in that sort of area. Or you could have it a seating arrangement or a drying area for various things, you know, washing them, say, in this day and age, rather than, you know, there's lots of things you could do to improve the quality of life for the residents. And what do they want? They want to put another one to get some more. I mean, obviously, from a financial view, it's how they look at it. But from our perspective, you're thinking, how do you police that? How can it be enforced? Whether someone's in there overnight, 1 week, or 6 months. And it certainly doesn't lend itself to, but however, that's you know, a personal view. So on the are we saying then that we should it will be difficult to
I might suggest, if you mind, to I'm not sure of the weight this will hold, but I would suggest that if you want to object to it, objection to the principle of that development, based on the fact that it's an unsustainable statement to say it's a short-term lens. It cannot be enforced and can't be policed effectively, and will lead to poor quality housing, residential accommodation by stealth below technical housing standards.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, we're okay for that and objecting that for the following.
I honestly can't say how much weight that'll hold, to be honest, because it's a bit hard to judge that in material planning grounds, but that I think is the issue.
Okay, then 22/1956, change of use to convert existing dwelling into two self contained flats, 333 West Street. Well, have a look. It's a terraced. Have a look. It's a terraced house. It's Frank. Frank. I always get confused. Frank, where was it there?
Yes.
On that bit there, that between there and the video. Probably. Yeah, more or less opposite the Barney's
church. Yeah.
Again, we've got issues on the waste storage and detail outs to enough space. Bike storage not detailed out. There's no first floor access to the property. I can't explain that. I'm just going to rotate this a bit, if that's okay. You can see the right orientation. So these are the existing and the proposed on the right. And that's how it exists right now. Basic two up, two down. And the proposed on the right here. To live a second. Oops. First floor is bedroom, living, kitchen. So it's a one bedroom flat. The second floor is only accessed through the front door. So can't see a means of them getting to this back yard to fulfill the waste.
So there's no fire escape at the back.
It's not a requirement. That would be a building regs issue anyway. It's always ideal to think about an external staircase, make it far safer, but the building regs and the fire safety will dictate the amount of smoke alarms and any sprinklers that may not be necessary, that sort of thing.
Because you said that it's the same as if it's like a normal house, isn't it?
Yeah. So
because you still have to come downstairs.
Yeah, the difference between it's normal, obviously you could take the waste out the back door, is the downstairs flat be able to into the yard where the bins would be. The risk would be what happens to the bins associated with the first floor flat. And it's not that the design of the space isn't that bad, it's just that it's not detailed out how it would be if we don't identify it, and if it becomes an issue, then obviously we might wonder why we didn't spot it.
So, okay, do you want to make comment in reference to
bins
and the usual parking? Because I think there's an alleyway behind it, when I look, there's an alley, you know, like there, wide alleyway, so.
There is good access to the rear, but yeah, that's going all the way around.
So I think the alleyway is painted as well.
Yeah,
I remember right.
I think you're right, yeah. So you know, you come out the front door there, go in the back there. And the yard is only that, so that's the shed.
Right,
so okay. Something comments of concern or consideration?
Just concerned about fire respect as well.
I think generally you're not concerned about the actual, what's inside the place.
Not the principle, it's just added detail for us.
It's just, just around the edges of that one on our tap, really.
Okay.
Right, so 22-22-85, ground floor rear side extension, 26 Deanside Avenue.
This is a really big plot.
This is off McLaren, isn't Deanside, isn't that behind the Oaks and Beans? Is that Deanside?
Yeah. It's called Sack.
Oh, called the Sack.
Yeah, it's on that plot there. And the building away.
Oh,
yeah. Enjoyed it there.
I love the left.
So the building away from the adjoining neighbour, who's extended to comparable map there. And that's the development aspect there, L shapes, pitch roof, single story. Those are roof lights. So the elevation. The elevation is pretty blank, so not intrusive in any way. But windows at low level, these are obviously pointing upwards, not into Jones Garden. And that's looking down the garden, a very nice big garden.
I always call them Velcro windows.
Velcro windows, that's how they fit it.
Yeah.
So we have no comment on that.
I'm going to say anything.
Not anybody. Okay.
Yeah.
Right, okay then. So the next one. 22-2008. Convert existing dwelling into two self-contained flats. 51 Law Street. We do have our third reference to the heritage assessment.
Yes.
So is it again the Baptist Church then?
Mm.
That what we're saying, or up from? I thought it was in the next block.
It's been planned in elevations. First things first. Broad Street. That's the unit there. That's side elevations. Come with a cellar.
Yeah. Probably the attic as well, man.
And again, looking at separate access is fine. And a little room in the centre, both the kitchen and dining. Any notes are made on this, access to the rear from the first floor again is clear, so bin storage would be a risk. It needs to be conditioned in some enforceable manner that they are only single bedroom units, one bedroom units, not single because they're being portioned out as one bedroom flats in the plan application, whereas the living space can quite easily be converted into a bedroom if we're not careful. So I'll just bear that in mind. And waste and cycle store just in detail out.
Could you just put where it actually is in the street? That's a little bit there.
Only a little yard.
So this is at the moment. I guess that is already in old speak bed sits.
I don't know. I'm trying to regularise the situation.
Yeah, yeah. It's because that's the church. There's the church. So I think this is already a rented property. And I spoke because of the various articles that have been in that area. They've got to tend to be now change them to flats rather than HMOs, because there's a lot of rented accommodation in particularly in North Street. So I guess to get around the back end is that alleyway there, it's not a wide alley, it's just a backs as we call it.
Let's go to that's for the purpose later on then.
Oh, here we go. Oxford Street now.
That's for another purpose later.
Google Earth.
It's a minute, I'm just looking to say. That's the property there.
That's in there.
And that's the backyard. So if we just drop in that little nosy, how do you access that?
That's it there, that gate. That's it.
So that's how the gate there.
Yeah.
And we've got a little bit along here. Ooh, so my driving's bad. Try and pull back a bit. It's not allowing us to see in between. So.
Yeah, well, that's the property, isn't it? They're making that into two.
That's the side access, and I believe there's a front access as well. No, there's not.
That's it.
So, there's a mention about how to try and retain that.
Yeah. Who works on?
Yeah. So that's the property in Blarney, Charlie.
Yeah.
So then we did.
It's longer than that, and it's narrower. That's why, because it looks a bit. But when you look from Union Street, it's not. It's just single width.
So it's just ensuring that, making sure that the bins get used in their storage area, and not out here on the house.
I think we need to put that, because I do know the fact that there are bins left on the corner. Not particularly.
There you go.
But on this corner where they have. Yeah. I don't know whether it's that property or it's around because.
Yeah.
But we do need to put that because it is a problem in the.
Yeah.
In North Street. So are we okay then with the actual inside?
No objection to the principal developments. I show. Details of access to the rear for the first floor property conditions and portable conditions. That they are single bedroom units, and ensuring there's adequate waste and cycle storage for the units. Not mentioning parking.
Yes. There's a parking there. one way street size.
Yeah.
Oh, that's different way. Go that way. Something that running. Okay.
It's going to go back a bit, so I've got the Oxford Street back up.
So the next one then, are we okay with that then?
Yeah.
Okay. So the next one then, 22-2041. Advertisement consent for four advertising signs placed at entrance points on the roundabout of the Queen Street and Grand Junction retail park.
There's not a lot of detail on there.
There's a picture of a signpost, presumably going to have sponsored roundabouts.
Yeah.
Do we have any... Do we need to go to look at it? Do you want to get a feel for what's coming to you soon?
Recently entered, not by me. If you notice, it's registered on behalf of One Chantry Court, which is our address.
Right.
That anyone can write any address on these things. I haven't entered this, and no one in this office has. I don't know if a councillor has entered that, or if a person has just entered it because they know our address and wanted to make it look like a councillor.
Well, it certainly
hasn't been entered by Crewe Town Council.
And what ad does it say then?
It's up on the screen now, and it says objective proposal, commentator's interest, MP or councillor. That could be true, but could not be true. I honestly don't know. Advertising signs are designed to attract attention. Putting them on roundabouts, which are dangerous enough without added distraction, seems reckless. I am sure answer means well, but it's not a good idea. And they put down our address now. That could be a councillor who put that, but there's no name on there. Or it could just be people who know where we are. I know for a fact it's not anyone from this office.
Well, I totally agree with that statement.
Well, I don't think they should have that, the advertising really on the roundabout. That's not, we need to be concentrating on the traffic, not
I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem with sponsoring roundabouts. Yeah, go anywhere else, they sponsor roundabouts. Don't have a problem whatsoever. However, I have a problem with that somebody, if that is a councillor that's done that, they don't need to do it that way. The councillor should just have put who they were. Because they quite legitimately can do that. And if they're not on this committee, then you're going to have your comment here and we'll resist. But if it's a councillor that, you know, I mean, you could have an idea who might well have sent that, but it's surprising that you haven't just put Councillor John Rhodes. Because if I felt that way, I'd done my hand up, you know.
It may be that the Cheshire system removes the name, I don't know, automatically.
But I think that it does, nothing seems to have names on it, does it?
Quite often in the case. I honestly don't know. It could well be a council, it could well not be a council, I honestly don't know. It's a representation. Members in line to object, and that's the proposal. But
does it have the size of
them? Yeah. Plans,
yeah. Well, I've just come back from Jersey. Nearly every roundabout has got advertising signs all the way around the
roundabout.
They're a meter across. Back.
So 3 foot 3.
3 foot 3, yeah.
Yeah.
And you're standing about a metre and a half to each other.
High level.
I haven't got a problem with being on there. As long as you can, but at the moment when I come around about, I use all of them. No, I'm not just looking to the right. I'm looking at what's coming round the roundabout from in front of me as well.
You can't see across that roundabout.
You can't see.
It's planted up. That's the one that turned Grand Junction Retail Park. You can't see across it.
Come off a bit of
it. I don't know. Maybe it's one on Jersey.
How much do this?
I'm not sleeping up for them.
I don't have anything to say for or against it, so...
I'm going to the wire on it. If that's the decision that you object for the reasons, then fine, let's move on. I don't want to spend a lot of time on it.
No.
I think you just have to monitor CDR students go around there. And then you might be blaming the signs for...
Or me?
No. I said the same.
Okay, there we are. it's an established practice to have sponsored roundabouts. I'm not saying it's right or it's wrong, I obviously don't have an opinion on it. I'm not here to represent what you want to say.
I suppose it has to be, the size has to be proportionate to the roundabout size, doesn't it? Because I travel up when my son was in Newcastle, and they've got sponsored by Joe's Plumbing or whatever, the flowers, generally speaking, what the sponsor is, they got the name, but they sponsored something on there. There's flowers and things like that, that's how you do it. Not just as it's an advert for the business, but they actually spend some money on starting it up. So, but anyway, let's not dwell on if there's a comment there that really we need to establish who's done that, because I'm not happy with that.
Okay.
Using this address and a counter. The councillor should, if it is a councillor or any individual, they should not be putting this address. Because we'll make comment now saying that we object to the following reasons, and that would be fine. That's,
yeah.
I just find it strange that if it is a council, they haven't just said, you know, because if you're on this committee, you can object to any or support any applications individually you want, can't you?
Yes.
Okay, let's look. Emma, I always look at you for a bit of sanity on these things. What?
Well, I don't like distractions when you're driving, but I don't.
No, yeah, that's fine.
That's my personal opinion, but, you know, it's...
Well, if I can move it on, Chair, to have move on, if you want to make a proposal of objection, then you will your seconder and it goes to the vote, and if more people vote for objection than either abstain or vote against, then it's an objection. So if you mind us do that, so that's up to you. If you're not, then we have to move on.
I'm not objecting to it.
Oh, okay.
I'm just saying. Oh, yeah, I'm just concerned about it. From a personal point of view, I suppose, really. I'm easily distracted at best at times when I'm driving. So. But you can't judge other people's driving. So, no, I'm not objecting. I'm just a bit concerned.
I propose we move on.
I think there's nothing to submit as a comment. I will email all members and find that you comment on applications. Feel free to please put down the correct contact details.
Yeah,
Right, I've just gone on to comment. It's required to put your details.
Mm.
And then is there a tick box? I just wonder. I don't know.
Residential comments are put on with their address but not the name, so it might have been a similar automated system.
I think it's the same because there's no tick box to say I don't want my name shown.
No, they don't.
So I think it's possibly an automatic thing.
Yeah, they don't tend to put your name.
No.
Do they?
No, well, I'll phrase something up as appropriate.
Is that okay? I mean, I don't want this because I say I'll live either way.
So I don't think it was done purposefully.
No. When I go around that corner, Williston, and they say make the chips one, you know, or the sign that says Williston, you know, Garden Village, or whatever it says, you know.
Yeah,
it makes you hungry. Anyway, let's not dwell on that in the great scheme of things. So, 22, 23, 27, proposed porch extension to front and single storey.
I think we've missed 1964. Oh,
that's because you put it all there, didn't you? Okay then, 22, 1964, ground floor rear extension to Oxford Street. And increased floor space as well.
Yeah.
There's another taxi office that's changing. Yeah, it says existing taxi office.
That's right. That's just on to Google if you don't mind. In the context of the site, we've had a few applications in for this.
We had a comment, didn't we, the other meetings about Oxford Street app. Supermarket.
That's right.
West Street.
The first floor.
Beyond that.
Aspect here, which wasn't too challenging, but previously it was amended design because they had put a door at first floor level with no apparent reason.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah.
And the issue was raised about on street waste along the slant from curved commercial waste. So let's drag it along. But there's a car yard here, which is fenced off with security fencing along the periphery there. And then this is the area of infill they're seeking to build into. So that's the taxi office, and that's their back storeroom. And they've got a first floor extension on here now, approved, I believe. I haven't checked, I apologise. But I'll show you in a second, I'll show you the elevations. That would be the only place to reasonably keep commercial waste off the highway, because that's an highway, that's pavement, and when we drop in to the street view, you'll see that there is a recordable issue with on-street waste.
That's on a good day,
I understand that, yeah. I've been there myself, to be fair. There's some more there. I can see the doors open. It might just be temporary there, but still it's indicative of an expectation. And down there is the gap we're talking about there.
Okay. It's a car, isn't
it? Yeah, that's a car. And that's the taxi office in the far distance. I can't take you down there. Now, obviously, you can't store a bin down there because that's car. So by infilling there, I would wonder very much how on earth we're going to store some waste. Because as you can see, there's a commercial storage there. We've got a little bit of a lean-to going on here, some more storage.
He's extended that upwards and all, you know.
I haven't seen that. I haven't been down this now.
Well, I go down there quite often, so you tend to know when somebody makes something that's a little bit of a shed into more of a permanent structure.
Yeah.
Well, that's a bit Heath Robinson, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think it's a little bit better now, but it is there.
That there, see that white bit? Yeah. That's the taxi office, and that's the fence separating this car yard from the bit there, and that's the open space for the input there. Okay, so that's a bit of context. So this is what we're talking about, retail floor space, and then the flip filling is that bit there. That's the filling they want to put in. Okay. And that's where we saw a few, you know, from the street view, there was a car bonnie sticking out of it. If you want to see more, that would be an elevation, very basic. It's nothing here, it's no architectural value, but it's not in the world. It's sitting a little bit proud by something, you know, there's going to be a coastal extension on there. That is the shop unit, the taxi office, and that's the infill aspect there. That's the existing, so nothing much to see on the existing, just a gap. There's the gap there, drawn form rather than picture form. Okay, so right, so on my notes, sorry to take the time chair. In infill development does not provide for commercial waste storage, no rights for waste storage on the highway or public realm. I'd have concern enough if members were minded to object to it on the basis of the risk to inadequate waste storage and the impact that'll have on the immunity of people in the area.
Well, if he's extending his floor space at the back, then that means he's going to have bigger deliveries. And it's bad enough there when he has to deliver it.
Yeah.
Even if it's with the second act and van, which is packed up on the pavement.
Mm.
When you deliver to the shop, because where that little shed was, if he has a fruit and veg delivery, it all gets chucked in there before it comes into the shop.
Mm-hmm.
So we just go and put pizza.
Yeah. Certainly not improving it, is it?
No,
to know what it is. That's what we'd be looking to incorporate off bins off the street and all that, because at times, the cardboard boxes. Go right up and along, yeah.
Okay.
So we're okay with that, colleagues, then?
Yeah,
okay then. So we'll go back to the one that I missed. 2327, an extension, 14 Furwood Walk. Porch extension, is there anything there of any note?
No.
Anybody looked and had comments?
It's a little extension to the front and a little extension to the back. It's no comments. When I looked about 3 hours ago, it's a very small application. Could be on the screen about 87 minutes by the time this computer's warmed up. So it's that rear extension and that porch there. So it's nothing too worrying or challenging. We've got Velcro windows on the top there. It's no on the side elevation. I haven't got anything to read.
Okay, we're all right with that then. Yeah, let's move on. Perhaps we can skip this one. 22/19/94, advertising consent for eternally LED and flex face boxes and various others harvests of and illuminated fret cut aluminium goalpost trays with 80 millimeter returns, whatever that means. This is harvests. What it means is that they're changing over to Matalan.
Yeah.
That's basically all it is. So yeah.
It's the same size. So.
No problem. That's fine. Thank you, Emma. You keep doing that, and I'm more than happy. Right. Okay.
I only have a problem with the retail part, but
then. Well, perhaps we can use that to the, when we get to the next one.
Yeah,
right, 22/19/57. This is solar heat pumps, air source heat pumps for various solar PV located to the section of the Danebank College, Salchester College, Danebank Avenue. Does anybody?
Well, basically, the report, who was it, the environmental report, whatever, saying there's insufficient information, there's no noise report. So, which is what the complaints are from the residents. So they need to come back to with information, basically, don't they?
Yes.
That sounds good. That sounds very good.
Can we just back that up?
Of course we can. Noise detailing. Yeah.
I even started doing about it.
Okay, we're happy with that then?
Yeah.
We can then, right. 21/58/85, change of use from dentist surgery to four apartments. We commented on this particular one when it was five apartments. I think it got withdrawn and it's now coming with four apartments, which, okay, so shall we look at this? Because
yeah, sure. I've got some notes on it as well. Interested.
Was this initially had comments from neighbours?
We've commented twice.
We've commented twice on it, objecting over development, the usual bins.
It was originally, we said this, sorry, originally five apartments that he had submitted under this application, and there's been a redesign, one or two, and this redesign has reduced it to four apartments. Where's the revised plan, sorry? Proposed elevations haven't changed, actually. Revised plans. This one might take a while to look. Just while it loads up, one's not meet the minimum technical housing standards of 39 square metres. Apartment two does not meet the minimum technical housing standards of 39 square metres. And I think we need to ensure there's no subdivision of the first floor. So 37.44 square metres are apartment one, not 39 square metres. And same goes here. They have shown a single bed. So one person, one bedroom flats are supposed to meet the minimum housing technical standard of 39 square metres. That's the government guidance. It's not just made up by anyone. That's made up by the government, I suppose. And none of those apartments meet that. And then the first floor, I think we commented on this in the past, but there is a risk that it could be subdivided in some way, although the kitchen area is down here. So it needs to be conditioned that remains as one household unit.
So what's the space, recommended space for a two bed?
It's less than 62.69 square,
which is what
I had it on the screen earlier today, so I haven't memorized it. It's not a massive amount, but it's less than that. And that one there is all right as well. I think it's 47 square meters for a two person, one bed flat. So those two
are below. Concern is those two then.
Those two are below minimum technical housing standards, and that one we want to see clarity of how it can be ensured it's not sublet. There's two units.
And then bin storage, was some bikes.
Yeah, the mini storage is there, and there is bike storage at the end as well. So, you could argue that demonstrated bike storage, not covered with storage. And there is adequate bin space that we could put in there, so it's not every word. They all have access to the rear yards. That's the access to the rear yard from the down the staircase. It's, and I believe, right, it looked, can I click across on the lid? Oh no, it's not like that. It's the elevations, I mean, it was one by the elevations. That's the back door, okay, that's all. So it's nothing that exciting, it's that aspect. And the side door, just for ease of access. Well, there we go.
So,
fire restraint?
Well, again, it's not a requirement. It's up to the safety, the building regs and the fire safety officers to decide. You could indicate how we might provide a some form of external ladder down there, but I don't think they fulfil the requirements anymore. I don't.
Well,
you can still, definitely mention it if you want
still
to.
Still say that we're concerned that
yeah,
we can't
yeah.
see a fire escape.
Just take me to the attic.
In the floor plan.
Well, whatever.
That mean
that one.
Yeah. Oh, it's the attic, isn't it? So our apartment is 1-2 on the ground floor. I'm a bit confused. This apartment's 1-2 on the ground, both on the ground floor.
Yeah.
Right. And then apartment 4 up in the attic.
Yeah, so apartment 4's up in the attic.
Right.
There is reduced headroom here, but the calculation is correct, and that still allows for adequate space.
Right.
All right, for short people.
If you're short, you get even better accommodation, but it's effectively 41 square meters now, less than 39.
Yeah. I mean, considering that initially when these houses would have been built, the attic would be for the maid.
Mm.
And they'd have they'd probably have a sink and a jug of water for washing, and you'd have a bed, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And now we're making it into visual. Apartment, aren't we?
Yeah.
With restricted headroom. Well, no. These are observations you make that they lead themselves to really nice apartments.
Yeah.
But clearly, they just want to get as many people in as they can.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
But bear in mind, we've still got to take note of what next door about. The fact about HMOs and articles for the rest of it.
Our comments have been submitted in December and April. You may want to repeat the concerns about HMO aspects and area, as well as identify some technical issues if you want.
Is that okay then to the committee? We've mentioned that as well.
I just wonder how many more HMOs we're going to get. Okay. Yes. Before we already reached that.
I think it's leading itself tonight to having all these two flats, two apartments is what we're going to now. For that, these would have been HMO. That one in Law Street, definitely, that would have been an HMO.
Yeah.
But there's that many there, they're having two. You know, to say no, you'll have to have that, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Are we okay then, colleagues? Yeah. We'll move on then. Talking of flats. 22-15-65. Change of use to residential flats on first and second floor, 5 Earl Street. That's above the chip oil in the Earl Street here.
Probably
these plans.
These are the colourful ones.
Yeah,
this is the one, isn't it? Middlewich. Is it Middlewich?
Well, I gave up looking at it, so I didn't get
it. I think the second page, is it? Oh, no, it's not this one. Well, this is the next to the co-op, is it Britannia Building, so whatever it was.
Co-op Bank.
The co-op bank now.
Yeah.
That restaurant, that chippy there, was closed for a while.
Yeah.
It's above there, it's keeping the restaurant below, and then the two, making it into quite and that's got a rear exit with the stairs.
Yeah.
Into that courtyard behind the theatre, really.
Right, that there is the restaurant aspect, and this here is your access upstairs. It is complicated, it's unnecessarily complicated.
Yeah.
Right, so the fire door on this first floor one shows down to the stairs there. And then that is a rear bedroom, studio apartment, bed sit thing. And there's its facilities. And the front of the property goes into another setup here. Now, what's confusing is they don't seem to have detailed in any wall at this point. So bedroom area two, bedroom area one. I'm not entirely sure what that's supposed to achieve. And I've put a note that indicates a shared living space rather than
does that look like a concert in the door that slides right across?
Yeah. On the left.
I've taken that to be indicated as they would have to detail that out in all this drawing work here. I've taken that to wardrobe space.
Yeah.
So it's a co-hangers to me.
Mm-hmm.
I could well be wrong. Well, that's, you know, I would worry about why there's no wall here.
There seems to be a door.
Door into the lounge.
Where it says bedroom two. Yeah. Now up further up.
Yeah, and the door there.
Yeah. Is that going into hall?
That's going into the hall area here.
Right, and the other door goes into his studio. Right, I'm with you. So you're right, there's no wall.
There's no wall there, I don't quite understand that detail. There's also no extraction demonstrated. Now, that could be on the building register, but it would affect the elevation. So it should be on the elevation drawings, but it's not, just as a technical bit. I could be wrong on that, of course, which is known. Happen. So on the notes, I'll come back a second. What's the next one? On the notes, the extraction of the kitchen and bathrooms, first and second floors, they're not detailed out on the elevations. Bedroom areas one and two on the first and second floor indicate shared living space. So let's zoom in on the second floor one, which is sort of similar. They've shown a dotted line here, which is a removed door. So I assume that building here, that they've put a stud wall in it. It's not clarified.
Mm.
It could just be a drawing error. Sorry.
What's that say? Removed door? Is that the door now? Yeah. So they're going to go straight across.
But it doesn't say that. That's a drawing wall.
Yeah.
That looks to me like either a supporting lintel or something or a removed wall to me. That's not a drawn-in wall. So I don't quite understand why they would do that. Which makes me a bit more worried.
They got some more squiggly lines as well, haven't they?
Yeah. And saying that is a fire service access there. But you know, that flat in and of itself isn't unreasonable. Realistically, bit tight, supposed to be for three people. I don't understand why those rooms aren't separate.
See one red comment.
Could it be something to make it seem like there's less bedrooms?
It could. Well, that's my worry. They're trying to keep it under the technical housing standards. And because it doesn't specify one bedroom, three people in those.
No. I think someone's trying to be clever.
So we'll maybe comment that it seems to be subverting the technical housing standards and stuff like
that. Low impact. Yeah. I'll leave it to you. I think we should object to that on the grounds of it's confusing us. And I'll let people put that in English.
Well, I think you should put it in a different way than that.
Yeah.
Well, it's not clear, is it?
No. Busy.
That's what I wrote on
the It's busy. I mean, you're led to believe that it'll be two, but we're actually looking at four, aren't we?
Yeah.
Two on each.
I think so, yeah.
But not, we're not object to the principle of living above a shop in the town centre, because we it's what we're to make sense of it, it's very difficult.
That business is quite a decent size. You know, that one there, studio apartment two, whatever they call it. But this little one seems to me that the subdivision process is a three-person, one-bed flat.
Yeah.
And the same goes for the one on the second floor.
Yeah. See, the problem I always have with these is in the early days when we were looking at different plans, they're not to scale. You're just taking as an assumption that is to scale, and it's not always the case. Mm. So you can look and say, oh, that looks.
Yeah.
It's to me.
Because I looked at thin beds.
Because I looked at that other one, it says 49 somewhere square, and then you look at other 28, and when you try and visualize that, it doesn't stack up. So I'm not that convinced unless you've got a proper drawing where it's scaled.
Mm. Yeah,
and you can be confident that it's accurate. That's the problem. What we are.
Yeah, and I'll give you some context. This room is approximately 60 square meters.
So you've got everything.
Yeah.
Are you talking from here then?
No, the whole lot. Give or take, that might be about 70 square meters, including the kitchen.
You've got a living space.
Approximately.
Some of them are 40. I mean, that one in the attic was 28, so work that one out, and it's got everything. The maid's bedroom.
Yeah.
So, okay, so what do I want to put on this then?
I feel that I'm directed to object on the grounds that the bedroom areas of one and two on the first and second floors indicate shared living spaces, which would be under technical housing standards. And that the detail is the elevations associated with extraction.
Yeah.
Anybody want to add anything? Okay with that?
Yep.
So object and for those reasons. Okay then, thank you. So the next one is, I guess that's the same one, first on the other page.
Oh, I duped
it.
Sorry.
Okay. So, 22-17-1770, outline application for infill dwelling to Howard Street.
Right, this is based, any comments that I'm going to make are based on the comments that have been shared by neighbours who seem to be quite concerned about this development. This is my nose. It's there. That's a location. Oh yes, sorry, it's only outlined, this wrong. Right. Doesn't help us out that. I'll go on the street in a second. Howard Street is one of the stoned access road. And that's Sturgeon Street there. Proposal is for an infill dwelling there off that access road. That's another street, and then that's the infill side there, and it does narrow at that point. And lots of the comments associated and blend the ones up front, I've taken the notes on that, to be provide such traffic control measures to ensure adequate vision display unhindered by parked cars on Herbert Street, demonstrate viability and sustainability of the passing spaces, and safe access to the rest of the site. Those are the comments that I read. That's someone wrote more than me. Just click a random one.
I didn't look into them in detail. I'm assuming that these have just been duplicated on here.
Yeah, I'll be honest, I went through a few of them and they all seem very, very similar. So I haven't memorized all of them, I'll be honest. That's the problem when people put identical, close to identical objections.
No, but what I'm saying is there's four on the 2nd of June for 9 Howard Street. There's
those ones on the
6th of June for 14 Howard Street.
Those are associated with, that's the objection there at the top of my point to that.
Yeah.
And these are photos to prove their point.
Oh, I see. Okay. And they've all done the same then.
So yeah. This gives you an idea. This is Howard Street and that's Herbert Street. Yeah. Because people park here. It's hard to see up and down the road when you're pulling out. I think it's better to get the next picture. I'm really sorry. So that's the issue. Is there adequate visual display because there's no parking control there? I only made the comment to represent the concern.
Yeah, and then Highways go and say, well, as it's an unadopted road, we don't need to make a comment. Which is helpful.
It's very, very unusual to find a comment from Highways that challenges a plan application. That's the access there, and that's there is the shed that's on the land.
It's more like an alleyway.
That's fine.
Well, it's just yeah.
Is it unadopted that way?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I haven't tested it on the land registry, but that's what the comments say. It's unusual to have a street light on it. Well, doesn't get a street light on an unadopted road.
But the highways have said that it was unadopted, so.
Is that, although actually in Herbert Street, or is it in that road? Because it could be right on the corner.
No, that's, you're looking from, with Herbert Street behind you, that's down
Herbert Street.
So that is there. It could be an old one, it doesn't work anymore, I obviously don't know.
No.
We'll have boxing cables.
Yeah,
and it is unusual to have that set up on a doctor. Can't telegraph poles.
So this fence here, this gate here,
that's an existing property. It's this fence line that was
so developed. It's an infill.
Yeah,
for a single house.
Single house.
Yeah.
Three bedroom
single house.
Yeah.
Which will have parking on it, won't it? Because it's quite a bit
space. It's in the gate. It's appropriate to the scale of the plot. I mean, it's on the edge of being a bit large, but it's not ridiculous.
So what difference is it going to make to Howard Street then?
I guess the people just want it to be as quiet as they can and have it, I would imagine.
But the people who live there will have cars. Well, that will not make any difference to what are those pictures that you've seen from Howard Street or wherever it's called, Herbert Street, will it?
Yeah.
So what we need to concentrate on an infill is that house. Is it reason? Yeah, the size of that house, if it's got off-road parking, I mean, you know. I mean,
the only problem they're going to have.
It's going to be potentially three extra cars going down.
Yeah, or one of the building.
They're
going to have the lorry carrying.
Yeah, I understand that. That's any development you've got,
that's
an extra problem. I understand that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Usually, the quieter the area, the more the object. Because if you're in a busy area like me, it's just fine. So what we're saying then, Colin?
Perhaps we should just say that because it's not substantiated plans, the only issue we would have is that it's in proportion to the actual plot.
The
size. Yeah, you can take that, it's no problem.
Yeah. I can't.
And this,
is what adding one house to that small road? I can't. I mean, I can see on the other side there's a former builder's yard with sheds, so that might be another one that's actually getting filled.
Yeah, that's access. That was pretty basic, obviously, to Allied Planning Commission, but that's showing how it would look, obviously, from a distance, which you can't get. in proportion to the building that's already there.
So there's absolutely just nothing there at the moment. No. It's just
grass. Well, yeah, if you would walk down there, it's an old fence panel and some bushes on it.
But when you look at that, where it says proposal, and then you look at that, I want to remind you before, where it was the outline, it looks twice as big as that.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
I know, yeah, yeah.
I'm presuming that it's number two that it belongs to. Because it's number 12 and the others have objected, but there's no objections for number two. Oh. Well, or they've sold it off.
Number six is opposite, isn't it?
Let's see what we find. Someone from Slack.
Slack.
Bloody followers.
Yeah, yeah. That's exciting. Kitchen, Jordan and Max.
I'm going to slow down a bit.
Kitchen,
it's a B&B for a long while, wasn't it? Yeah. Just out. Years.
I'm sure it's a B&B when I first came here.
Yeah, that's the rear. It's like a
triangle. Is that what they're going to call the garden?
Well, it's, they might even finish the ride. There's something here, something here, something here. But that's what they're saying is the adequate outdoor space. And,
what is that? How many kids are
we going to
have there?
Handful. Doesn't that many?
No.
There is no.
You see, people get this wrong end of the stick, don't they? When when it says that it's normally.
It's four, three, four, five.
Yeah.
There's there was more than four or five bedrooms.
Yeah, but there'll be other facilities reported.
There'll
be staff staying overnight.
Yeah.
I mean, we've looked at them on, you know, Nantwich Road, various, off that, other side of Nantwich Road, and they usually say very small number, but you've got an equal number of staff, because you've always got at least two on site, and overnight, and it's 24/7, you know. And
well, at least it's a lot quieter than the one that's on the Nantwich Road.
Which is like any other looking at this, and the other, it's on street parking, and we would have to put something up, and that's what this
can guy be said. Other than that, there's the traffic there. You know,
yes,
so. It is very busy. Yeah,
well, it's even busier now because of the part of the rapid.
They've got staff diversion. Yeah, they've got staff parking there on shifts.
Indicating that back road, which is where they're going to park. Well, indicating that's where the parking is, isn't it? That's what they're indicating. Oh, so that's just a bit of an outdoor space. So then that means the kids have got nowhere to go. Well, I tell you, what you'll do well to turn your car around in that, if you reverse it out. So I mean, that's an old one. Yeah, I don't. Anyway, let's look at that. What we're going to say then. That we support it, but other than we've got reservations about parking, or
I can say because it's outdoor space.
I think it's lacking something very important.
It can be difficult getting out of that junction opposite that building.
Yes,
because the granddaughters of that space. I went out there. There was a building found parts of that I couldn't see. I couldn't see left and I could only just see right.
So which road was that you were coming out of?
It's the one that Newfield goes on,
isn't it?
I know, really, yeah. So it's difficult there,
But you'd counter that, wouldn't you, by saying, well, it used to be a guest house.
Yes. You see, parking. These plans, are they actually, this is how many bedrooms are going to have?
It doesn't seem to show any internal alterations on the plans that I can find.
No, the plans are actually showing as the existing plan.
It's the change of use is what the application is for.
Because
if it
is for that number of children, because it's quite a lot, isn't it? Number of bedrooms, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. And then the annex has got three, so that's 13 bedrooms. So you could have 10 children there.
I don't think it says that in the right.
What? No, but this is what I'm just saying.
Yeah,
good. And then the fact it's got no outside space whatsoever because they use a natural parking. Yeah, it's not suitable.
It's not. I would agree.
So we need to flag up. Flag up that concern.
Yeah.
For that reason, there's nothing wrong with the building. It's the lack of outside space for children.
If it is that number, you know, that large number of children. Even if it was a smaller number of children, there's no real outdoor space that they're using that for parking.
Yeah, I think it says the age is a very wide range of age.
It was.
I think when you read it. I know they changed them in laws. House in four Lawton Street is a very smallish, and they didn't make laws, even though it was a brothel behind it. It took, you know, took so long, it didn't make any odds to them. They just passed
it. Well, this is in the better area.
I mean, it goes because it's with either emotional and behavioral difficulties or low to moderate learning difficulties, and then it goes on to say. Would provide a deeply nurturing environment. Well, if there's no outdoor space, that's not nurturing in my view.
Okay, so let's capture that then, Pete.
I've currently got down lack of outdoor space and amenity, unclear of the resident density and unclear resident members and density, unclear of the layout and any internal changes associated. I've missed anything.
Is that all right then?
Actually, lack of parking.
Oh, wait a minute. Our purpose, the home will accommodate up to four children and people of both genders. Up to four.
Yeah, I know it's not a high number.
Okay, so we don't say that then. So, yeah, okay.
Up to four children and young people. So that's not necessarily saying it's four, is it?
No.
Up to four children and young people.
I still think it's up to four. I think that there might be a social worker definition associated with what's a child and what's a young person.
Yeah.
It goes up to 18 or something like that, generally. 16. No, I mean, when they put these applications in, is it from a right early age to around about that 16, 18, you know? It's generally, obviously, there are some issues in some of them around the area where we live, because we've got five or six in an area where I live, but these still, and they're well run, well maintained, there's no doubt about that. And they don't cut corners with the staff and that, but it's very difficult. Yeah.
There is lots of outdoor space for children to enjoy games in the large garden. What large garden is that?
It only shows
there that.
There
isn't
yard.
The large garden.
Okay. So let's just put insufficient outside space for children.
It is a large garden.
For children to be nurtured.
Yeah, keeps it lying down the road somewhere.
Right, we'll capture that then in the facts of what.
Doesn't add up.
Our view.
No.
Right. And the layout inside and the parking.
Yeah.
But you can't have it both ways. You can't have then a large outside area where they can be, and then on the other hand, they're saying they can also park there as well.
Yeah.
You can't have a cake and eat it, can they?
Can I be clear? Are we objecting or raising concern? What's the situation?
I think we should be objecting.
I don't think that's suitable.
Okay.
That's fine. If you're okay with that?
Yeah.
That's fine. Okay. The next one then. 22.2178. A conversion to a habitable building. And change of use to a self-catering holiday unit and premises. Just had one of these in Market Street, haven't we?
We have, yes.
Obviously, catching on. The Coach House, 1A Hungerford Avenue.
Didn't know there was a coach house there.
No, it's new to me.
You're going to have a holiday let soon. From Hungerford Road, haven't you? Right, Pete, can we just let's be very serious?
Yeah,
let's have a look. It's a nice avenue, is Wumbleford Avenue, to this day. Very nice houses down there.
So that's on the road, Wumbleford Avenue is here. And this relates to a premises that sits at the back, 210 on the road, and it is there.
Right.
And then, that's existing, what it is. And it's an outbuilding, two-storey outbuilding, workshop and store. It's always been used in the past. I can access it off Avenue to that space there. I can take it up to the street view if it happens to stay.
Yeah, you can see it from the location.
And then that's the proposal for that space. There's no external changes apart from they're going to turn it into the kitchen, living room downstairs, shower, bathroom, and a mezzanine bedroom upstairs. I'm saying mezzanine, I don't know, it's not mezzanine at all, it's enclosed. It's enclosed upstairs, especially. There's bin storage. It's a funny one. It would make a nice little holiday. The risk is always, what is it actually going to be used for?
Well, I'm saying Cornwall would be nice.
The meeting with the market for it and that sort of thing. Whilst we all adore Crewe, I'm not convinced of its significant tourism market.
How long does it take to get to the beach?
nearest builders yard.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. I'll just take you onto that road. So you can see in context, it's a hard one to say it's a bad idea,
I'm not quite sure how you can object to it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's only the risk of what it may actually be used for. There it is.
It's sensible to make it habitable.
Yes.
You know, so, and you've got a parking space, and you know, so isn't any reason to object to it.
Isn't it like that building, John, that was at the end of, is it 5 Norton Street, the house on the corner where?
Very similar to that. Well, it's bigger than that. It was a coach. Yeah. Called it a coach house,
that's right. Yes, that's,
and they made that into two little flats, you know.
I think the thing that's putting me off is that it's a holiday there. They said they wanted to put a house there, but a single sort of bedroom house.
The only thing, having needed to go and stay near family, and we've used Airbnbs and things in odd places. So there's that side of it.
Fair enough.
They're asking for that specific use. So if that's the use, then are they restricted to that?
Well, if that's the planning consent, it's for self-catering holiday union, then yes, they should be restricted to that. It's just how you release it. So I have made note of such enforceable conditions as ensure the unit is not used as a long-term residence or dwelling, and the unit is not to be subdivided from the main residence. Well, I agree with you because actually the design's pretty reasonable and it's a good use of the space. I don't disagree with you at all. It's just the risk management.
It looks like it's been there a long time though, doesn't it?
It's been put up when the house was bought back, I guess.
I was looking at that roof, that's been there a long
time. It's not had a lot of heat inside, it's keeping nice and dry. But I'm not saying objective, I'm just raising the only risk management there is that it is used for the purposes of use.
It's just a choice of words of use holiday. It's no different than where you've got houses where you've got this, what's it, AB, well, I call it NIB. You can just come in and they get a cold, they go in and stop, we get businessmen park. I've got 1-3 doors for me. You just get businessmen coming, stopping 2 or 3 nights, off they go. You know, you'd be surprised how many people actually come and that working in the area, maybe Bentley, or rather than spend in a hotel. So I don't, that to me is a good use of that particular building. But but you got to, you know, it's the way they put the words holiday.
Yes, that's what we're consenting for. So we'd be happy with that. That's fine.
So we leave it.
Yeah.
Is that okay? I'm not mindful of your time. Okay, then. 22-21-18, variation on condition number 6 on existing permission P94, now bear in mind 94 is 1994, 0529, erection of 2 non-food retail units with associated car parking. Unit 13, Grand Junction Way. Now this is where they want to make it a gym.
And we have a comment from 64 Bedford Gardens,
which is a very, 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 very relevant comment, because we've always commented about trying to preserve the town centre, what bit we've got left, and not transferring. When you've now got, for example, you've got Marks and Spencer's, make a lovely gym. Well, you know, they used to say, well, we can't go in the town centre because the shops aren't big enough, there's no empty shop. Well, they've got loads of ready-made place, so don't need to go on any road. Shall we look at it and make comment, and then we'll put 64 Bedford Gardens are who makes comment, very sensible.
So, well, basically, what that comment is saying is that there is a restriction at the moment that would preclude it being used as a gym, and that should be maintained.
We should support that.
I have difficulty with the problem of driver access to the retail park anyway. If you're going to have a gym on there, how much more is that going to add to it? You know, if it was a well-used gym, the amount of cars coming off and on there will be quite increased. So that's my concern.
Although I agree with what you're saying, if you got a shop that was very popular, you'd most probably get the same amount of vehicles and people going to that. I don't know. I'm not arguing. I agree with the first bit you said about there's something saying that we should be leaving and bringing them to the place. So, I don't know.
I think it sounds like you're proposing to object on very similar grounds to 64 Bedford Gardens.
Yeah, is that okay then? Because I think we've got that, what the individuals put. Protect the town centre. Okay then. So 22-21-13, alterations to elevation, through windows, various glazing, minor works, to Ronald McDonald's restaurant of 100 Dunwoody Way. Does anybody have any strong views one way or the other? If we have no objections, shall we move on? Okay, no. We'll have a big map there. 22-23-07, demolition of existing locomotive storage unit, followed by erection of a replacement one, substantially larger, crude diesel depot. That can only be good.
That can only be good, can it?
Typical railway. Roman,
does anybody have any views one way or the other? Just let them get on with it.
I take it that's
the Auslanding.
The Auslanding. Yeah, that's all.
I'm
just wanted to make sure.
As I would say, Auslanding.
Yeah.
Right. So okay then. So that concludes item 5.
Just to be clear, that one is there because it's at Southern Planning on Wednesday. The Town Council objected to it, and it's recommended for refusal by the planning officer report. And I've
not got that one.
We're talking about 91.
No, we're talking about 91 Hungerford Road.
Yeah, 21446.
Yeah, well, I haven't got it on there. That's probably why I haven't got it out.
It's a mark on you. It's got faulty printout.
Yeah, I've done.
That's why I didn't do it, colleagues.
We won't
blame
you. We won't blame you.
Colleagues, I knew it was like that when I got that. Okay, then. Apologies to the World Wide Web. Let's go back. 21446. Change of use, 6-bedroom, 6-person to 9 persons. We made comment when it was 6, yeah. We said it's all a development, it was bobbins, basically, without going through all the words we used.
Yeah.
And now they want to make it 9 persons. Are we still saying we object for the
Our objection, and this is notice that's going to some plan on Wednesday, right. Which is just to let you know that it's there and it's recommended and refused by the panel. So I will be at Southern Planning, so I am, it's okay, I'm just going to speak on this one, just in support of our previous statement. So.
Right, it's okay. Sorry about that, Holly.
No, your fault.
I'm set up there. Right, item 6 then, to consider making responses any urgent planning application.
There's one, and that is 222131. Which is the first floor extension to the rear dwelling line tree. I think this one.
Come on, got it.
Repeat yourself. That's the existing first floor plan, and then put it on that extension on the back. What else we got? That's it there, that's the extension. Elevation. So it's this addition here to the first floor. So let's go on the side. See the different issues with it. It's not seeking to overlook. Anything you want to see or talk about on it? Sorry, I haven't got
Is it a semi?
Yeah.
I can't see
them. Yeah, semis, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely.
No.
It's all right.
No.
All right, yeah.
Okay.
And that's that.
Thank you. Right, is that?
That's it.
Okay. So item 7, I'll just rattle through quickly. To no responses submitted under delegation since the previous meeting, none. However, 7.1, delegation of decisions agreed process. And there is a report that
take it, Peters. Yeah, I knocked it up.
So we don't get caught in between meetings, but we have meetings every month now. We do it. And if we're caught in between now that they've, before we've had opportunity to comment on one earlier in the meeting, it'd already been past 625 West Street. Yeah. It'd be useful if we could get something where. As we would do when we commented in our meeting, Pete sends, we agree it, send it out to committee, any changes, and then we submit. So we'll be in the deadline. Is that summed up?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I've just written out in the report I circulated like a protocol, effectively, just what the process we follow, which is I'll draft, identifies the risk of an application being decided before the meeting's going to happen. Draft up any potential response, share it with the committee, doing consultation with the chair at all times. And any comments come back from the committee, we absorb those into the response and submit the response and then inform the committee of that formally at the next meeting. That's it. Then we're asked to that in the instance of a serious or scale or strategic plan application. Proposals to the clerk will seek confirmation from the planning authority that response from Crewe Town Council will be accepted following the next level of planning committee. If the delay is not agreed by the planning authority, Aspects 1 to 6 above will be followed, with the option of an extraordinary reasoning committee convened if members are so minded.
Is that okay, Colin? So can we have a proposal in the second? So we did it So we're all okay with that then, to adopt that, so we won't get caught in which way. Thank you. So item 8. To note and consider correspondence causes of concern, etc. The first one, 8.1 North West Crew Package. Now, we're all aware that there was some, there is some problems accessing Medwick's Road, Latin Hospital, and all the rest. There's been a lot of generated. Now, we know, for those of us who are on the planning committee, when we looked at the North West Package and closing of Pimm's Lane and Sunnybank, this Crewe Town Council objected to them closing those particular roads until the North West Package Road was built. But of course, we got ignored because we live in Crewe and the area, so we understood what would happen. And indeed, Bentley got their way, it was short. Now, they've started building it, and it's horrendous for some people can't get out of their houses in West Street. The traffic's horrendous.
Takes you 10 minutes to get out of Ford Lane into West Street.
Yep. It's horrendous, isn't it? So, I felt we needed to, because we were, I was accused of this, that, and Pete, you wrote.
I wrote to the lead officers at Cheshire East Associates.
Was instructed it.
Yeah. Expressing that it's unacceptable to have an 18-week plan and what's going to be done to mitigate the impacts and the issues being faced by residents and businesses, and seeking demonstrable improvement in the approach, taking the issue forward to the members. It's all been circulating in the back, obviously, I understand sometimes. I did get a response off them, which I'm going to read out. I would like to read, this is from someone leading this Northwest Package project. I would like to reassure you that we take the needs of local residents very seriously and avoid imposing undue and unnecessary disruption wherever possible. As I trust you are aware, the Northwest Crewe Package scheme involves the construction of 6 new junctions connecting to the existing roads. The first phase of work, which requires the closure of 850 between Pimm's Lane and Smithy Lane, is for the construction of 2 roundabouts and has always been expected to be the most crucial element that has been potential to cause the greatest disruption. These works are programmed to the end in October, where works will move to the third roundabout and this section of the A50 will be reopened. The traffic management arrangements will then change as the works progress, and we envisage will reduce the current pressures being experienced on the town's internal road network. Further works within the programme will require the periodic closure of Smithy Lane, Flowers Lane and Mitchell New Road, but we do not expect similar congestion on the town's roads as the A50 will be fully reopened to traffic and only minimal diversion routes around Lane and Hospital traffic. The delivery team are in continual communication with Cheshire East Highways Network Management and look to address problematic congestion issues as they arise or are identified to them. The council's dedicated scheme webpage is being regularly updated to inform current progress and traffic management arrangements, and further information can be found out. Current construction programme forecast indicates an 80-week period of works on or around the existing highway, but this does not result in 80 weeks of road closures, as some people have referred.
Can't we get them to say that in the press? Because I am sick to death of Mr. Bush. I mean, Mr. Somebody used to be the leader of Tory crew and that, which
okay.
I don't want to say his name.
I did actually see something this evening
on
social media was saying something about that.
He keeps going on Facebook, especially on the Sydney page where people write about it's going to be shut for 80 weeks.
Oh, yes.
And I've answered him a couple of times and turned around and said, no, it's not.
But he just ignores me, which is...
True map news, 2 hours ago, Middlewich Road will be fully open from Popham Lane, Crewe roundabout to Spindly Lane from October.
Oh. Hallelujah. Forget what I just said. If you can.
Well, I think they made a rod for their own backs, yeah, because they clearly said 80 weeks, yeah, and the signs were there for 80 weeks. So they made a rod for their own back, and it's only because, not just the town council, but Cheshire East local councillors, yeah, have lobbied to say, well, look, put what it actually is and change your sign.
Yeah.
So, that, I mean, if, you know, I mean...
Yeah. Even October is bad enough. But at least people are going to now see that after seeing that aisle, at least it's going to work. I say it's not October, so it's not 80 weeks. But I'm just going to feel out a bit.
All right, okay. So, thank you, Jen. Yeah. Right. Yeah. You've done as instructed from the effort there.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next one then, we're just going to touch on this, Crewe cycling pedestrian schemes. We've all had opportunity to fill in, we've all been doing it. But there was a very interesting comment by a resident reference to the Mill Street walk when we get somewhere around here.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's not really safe, question mark, that you may have a different view. But the principle's fine getting you down here, but then it looks a bit... I didn't quite understand when I looked at it what actually it meant. But there's some dark, place,
yeah,
stairs or ramps or... Can you explain briefly?
Well, we can respond maybe mine say so. The principle is to make the pedestrian access or active travel access, cycling, from Mill Street to effectively out in front of our office here, far easier. So take out that bit of scrap land on High Street, come through the wall, just the other side of there, and come through this open bit of back car park and space for what is home bargains,
yeah,
and then out onto Forge Street and by the lifestyle centre. That's a great and in principle a positive thing. It's only going to enhance that environment, which isn't ideal as it stands right now. The issue comes that scheme does not, it comes in a level access with Ford Street, which you can't see because the blinds are always shut, but it's at our first floor level, or just below our first floor level. So everything below that and to the side of it will be low down and dark. And there is a risk, I believe, a real risk that design will lead to really nice spots for antisocial behaviour. And the other issue raised by a resident is by coming in level with 4th Street here, they're proposing steps down to us and steps down to Home Bargains, which removes the only level access to Home Bargains from the town centre for those who need level access.
Mm.
So there are two design issues, as far as I can understand it, in that aspect. Now, Councillor Wye, Ben Wye, has asked that we consider responding just for the full support of the packages. That's all up to you. I'm just sharing the concerns raised by residents, which are very reasonably put forward and by no means promoted. They're stated in very even tones. And they identify the fact, as it was circulated, that this level access will be removed. As we know, it comes down around in front of us here. You can get straight to Home Bargains and on to Tesco on level access. Kids Tesco a bit early, a bit around, but it is what it is. But by putting it in level access, you remove it, and they would have to now go a long way around to get access. And I'll be absolutely frank, it's not scientific, but I can tell you now, spending most of my day just looking out windows, obviously, there are lots of people with mobility issues who use that space. Yeah. You know, with wheels, effectively, going up and down, people who need to pull their shopping along the trolleys as well. And so it will have an impact. It's good that this person has raised it, because I haven't blocked it, I'll be absolutely frank.
I think it's important we raise it.
Okay. Well, just so you know, as an individual, I have raised it, but as a council,
yeah,
I have to be direct.
I think we can put something together as Crewe Town Council, can't we?
Yeah, we can make comment now, yeah, if you wish.
Yeah. Yeah.
That we support the scheme in principle, however.
We are concerned about this area and then the access.
If I may, I'd like to suggest that I can reply in not confrontational terms, quite strong terms about it. We'll more than concerned that this will be of issues in the future that will need to be addressed.
Yeah.
Right. Isn't there another alternative which the issue is to say that the other alternative is more expensive? I've read it somewhere that there was three proposals coming down here. One of them, unless it was down at the roundabout, I'm not too sure, but one of them, he said, one of the proposals was expensive to put in.
It might be that we're talking then about the Mill Street aspect from the station down to the Mill Street rail bridge, and that's where the difficulty is. Yeah. Because any intervention there will impinge on the two-way traffic, and that's the expense. Yeah. Maybe what you're referring to. I don't know about this one. I could be wrong.
This. Yeah. I think I read that in the brochure that I picked up from Crewe Station when
I think it was mentioned in that.
This roundabout's mentioned down here, and there's more than one alternative within that bridge.
Yeah, this particular job isn't that bit. This relates to the onward part of that. But yes, you're right, that's the Mill Street corridor, I think that's called. That there is a real problem that they face and how they address Mill Street Rail Bridge as it gets onto Oak Street roundabout. Because I don't pretend to have the answer to it, because you've got two-way traffic that can just about fit. Any intervention there will impinge on it, so it's going to be very expensive.
I think the whole scheme's quite expensive, to be honest. Mm-hmm. Whatever, but I do think
we need to make.
Yeah. So we need to record here that we're not submitting.
Not submitting open support for it, but we can support the principle and positivity of investment.
But however, we can. Against
the details that's associated with it, right. It depends on the level of see if it creates unsuitability, the hotspots, potentially erect to the site. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to rattle through now because I want to go past standing orders. But now, just two statements. Proposed stopping up of highway at Charles Street.
Sorry, Chair, 8.3. We're asked to formally support the Nantwich Road Bridge Enhancement Scheme. Yes.
That's the one that goes into Western Road.
Yep.
Yeah.
Just
more that I can respond to that. Great. Sorry, Chair.
Okay.
Yes.
So, they want to stop up 8.4 Charles Street and 8.5 Tower Way. This is where they've knocked all the buildings down off Queensway. Tower Way was the one behind the tower, obviously, Clock Tower. And Charles Street is the one that comes higher up.
Yeah.
Down there, us.
Yeah. Next behind the bus station.
Yeah.
The bus and the sheds.
So, okay, so that's just a statement, isn't it?
Yeah, because it's a staffing process.
Okay.
No votes.
So, item 9, update on planning application, well, 22.1 through...
I'm afraid it's 8.6, Chair.
Wait, I haven't got 8.6.
What's that mean, it's printing?
I don't know. I'm just a chair that's being set up. No, I've got that.
Yeah,
I told you it would be a bad day when I started, didn't I?
You did, yeah.
8.6, colleagues. Apologies yet again. Representation on behalf of the council relating to the government information on HS2.
Yes, I've been asked to bring that to you. Cheshire East has, this is a technical statutory process whilst we're approached the second reading of the HS2B bill in the House of Parliament. There is a process called petition the government for a particular draft act, and that doesn't mean getting a lot of signatures. Petitioning just means making a representation, a legal representation. Now, it's a very, very formal statutory process. I have never done it before. I have no knowledge of how to do it, but what I've read on the tinterweb. And I've been asked to come to Cheshire East. His petition has been going through that process now and has already had authorization to petition, and it requires them to create a case. They're petitioning against it because they're seeking far greater investment in the whole station of Crewe than has been proposed in the bill. They're not against HS2B, they're against the reduction in expectation associated with the investment in the station. And I think most of the council, not all the council, would support that position. We want HS2, but we want the full investment to benefit Crewe, its residents, and its future. Now, we've been asked to raise the option of whether we petition as well, and I will do as I am directed. We did very well in the judicial review, first time I've done that as well. There is a very significant risk here that the deadline is 5 p.m. on the 4th of August. It sounds miles away, it really isn't, it's the end of July. It's by practice of terms of what time we've got available to us, it's 3.5 weeks away because people are on holiday, so you know, that should be horrible, there's no one else who can do the work. We would have to appoint a parliamentary agent, which is, there'd be specialist consultants, that would cost significant amounts of money. And they would have to make the case and make the petition there. I don't know if they could do it at the time or not. I obviously couldn't tell you that. The issue would be also we would need council authority to do that. So we'd have to call an extraordinary meeting of council. I'm really sorry. Extraordinary meeting of council to authorise that work. My opinion is that we should be openly supportive of Cheshire East view on petitioning. That we should make representations, I'm being really quick because I've noted the time, make representations to the MP on the same basis, and if you want, you can direct to go forward with the petition and make it the relevant meetings, but I argue that it's likely it's too late. Not saying give in, I'm just making that statement.
Can you explore it?
I can certainly contact an agent,
it's too late or not, because obviously if it's not too late, then I think we should proceed.
It's technically not too late because the date is the 4th of August.
But for
practically speaking,
that's what I mean.
I will happily contact the parliamentary agents to see what comes back, and they're the only people who can tell me, but I'm not sure we'll tell them without paying them a lot of money. I've got the authority to
do
it. Can I propose that Pete does what he can and let us know?
Yeah, it smells smells expensive to me that way. Okay.
Okay, Alex.
So you're gonna go down the route and see where that takes us.
Yeah.
Hopefully I've got everything right. So the next one is 9, which is an application for the corner of Ellison Road. That is going Wednesday to Southern Planning.
Yeah.
Pete's going on behalf of the committee. When comments have been made, and we'll go from there. And last but not least, to note the date of the next meeting. Monday, the 18th of July at 6 p.m. I don't think there's anything else, colleagues. So I'll close the meeting, and I'm going to get a flannel now in a dark room and calm down. So, okay, well, have a safe journey home, and I'll see you tomorrow if you're there. If not, I'll see you in the future.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pete. Thank you all. Right, you have that that's correct.
Can you find that?
Yeah, but I can't understand why that was 86 is off. I don't understand the other. Mr. Rottenby.
We got printed on my iPod.
To bring me on.